by Facebook Live and other means. You continue to enjoy your lunch as well. We have a wonderful convening of friends from not just here in New York, but across the country that have joined us today to celebrate what would be the 93rd birthday of our founder, First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy. I'd like to thank the Vice Chairperson of our Board of Directors, Teresa Carlson, for her opening remarks and for the dynamic leadership that she brings to our board and her energy, which I'm sure you got a taste of this morning. We also have three other members of our Board of Directors who are here today. John Barrett is here. And that was his beautiful wife, Teresa, leading the applause for John. But and actually, Teresa's on our National Council of White House History. We have many of those members here today as well. Also, Tham Kanalikum is on our board of directors, and Tham is a great friend and supporter. And Barbara Perry on our board of directors, who you will see as part of the program in just a few moments, and I'll be giving a little bit more of an introduction to her. I'm Stewart McLaurin, and I have the privilege of being the president of the White House Historical Association. And in my ninth year in this role, we've had the opportunity to gather and convene to celebrate Mrs. Kennedy, her life, her leadership, and her extraordinary legacy many times. But as Teresa shared, it's actually been 3 years since we've been able to convene in person in this wonderful space. So before I do introduce our speakers, I want to take just a moment to talk about the importance of legacy and Mrs. Kennedy's legacy and what that means to us and what I believe that means to our country. There are several words that come to mind when you think of the word legacy and the meaning of the word legacy. It's impact. It's inheritance, what's passed down generation to generation to generation. It's the gift for future generations. White House doesn't belong to any current president or first lady. Does it belong just to those who have lived there in the past? But it belongs to future generations. And we, as the White House Historical Association, have the honor and the privilege of maintaining that on behalf of the American people. You all know that we accept no federal government money. Everything we do is with non-taxpayer funding. But when you walk into those beautiful rooms on the state floor, the ground floor, upstairs, and Tham has done a magnificent job working collaboratively with Mrs. Trump during their years in maintaining and restoring these beautiful spaces. But when you go into those spaces, every single thing that you see, decorative arts, fine arts, furnishings, rugs, draperies, was either acquired by the White House Historical Association, or we pay to maintain it or fund it, to conserve it, to preserve it, or in the case of rugs and draperies, to completely replace them. But since the Kennedys, there's been a White House collection. And like a great museum, these things are maintained and kept to a museum standard so that generation after generation after generation, thanks to Jacqueline Kennedy, what she called the house that belongs to the American people is preserved for every future generation. And that's with great thanks and gratitude to our friends in this room and our friends who are watching by Facebook Live. Well, Teresa, I have a little bit of a surprise for you. Earlier in your remarks, you referenced a book that was first published in July of 1962, 60 years ago this month, and it was mandated that we publish it by Mrs. Kennedy, who had been to the White House as a young girl and was concerned that there was no guidebook like you get at the Metropolitan Museum of Art or a great museum. So the first order of business for us was to create a guidebook, and that started us on a wonderful path and progression of publishing, which continues to this day. And I'm happy to share that today, we have released the 26th edition, the 60th anniversary issue of the guidebook. And Teresa, I'm going to give a hot off the press copy to you. The First Lady of the United States doesn't even have this copy yet. That's right. That's right. That's right. So you win the door prize. That's exactly right. So we have wonderful treasure trove of books, and you can go on our website or go into our shops in Washington and get this wonderful book. It's the best, the most substantive, the most beautifully photographed book that we've done related to the White House and its interiors. Well, there's one other thing that I'm excited about today before I introduce our program, and that is tonight in Brooklyn, for the very first time, we are convening our next gen leaders, 22 to 35-year-olds from all across the country that are the future of our work, the future of our country. And so they are joining with us to take on this mission and to share with their generation the importance of maintaining the president's home. Our role and responsibility is the same regardless of who the president of the United States may be. We've had the privilege of working with 11 presidents and first ladies since Mrs. Kennedy and President Kennedy. And so now we have this next generation of young people, young men and women in every profession that are a part of this dynamic group. And I have to say, as much as I love our board and our National Council on White House History, I'm most excited about this next generation group because we now have somebody that is eager there to take that torch and work with us and move our work into the future. So I'm really excited about that. Well, with that, I want to introduce our two program participants, and you are really in for a treat today. It's two of my favorite people in to give and share historic perspective on the White House and on our subject today, President and Mrs. Kennedy. Mark Updegrove is a great friend of mine and a friend of the White House Historical Association. He's the president and chief executive officer of the LBJ Foundation in Austin, Texas. He serves as the presidential historian for ABC News, and you'll frequently see him on ABC giving commentary about current events, but also from a historical perspective. He has written for a number of publications, the New York Times, Politico, Time, USA Today, and he's actually personally conducted in-person, in-depth interviews with 7 presidents of the United States, which is pretty extraordinary. He has a brand new book, and I'm sure you all know about this because you all listened to my 1600 Sessions podcast, in which I had a great conversation with Mark. But this is his brand new book, Incomparable Grace, JFK in the Presidency. And we'll be talking about this book a little bit, but not enough that would keep you from buying it. So get Mark's book and read this book. I asked him in our podcast, what possibly is there new to know about JFK? What can be known or shared that hasn't been written about? And he started rattling off and sharing things. And there's so much in this book. It's a quick read, a fast read, and I really encourage you to get this book. So thank you, Mark, very much for being with us today. Dr. Barbara Perry on our board of directors is the Gerald Baliles Professor and Director of Presidential Studies at the very renowned and distinguished Miller Center at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville, where she co-directs the Presidential Oral History Program. Now, this is an icon of American presidential history. They are the authorities on presidential administrations and the people who populated them, not just the president, but every appointed and senior staff person, and they maintain this archive of oral histories, which is incredibly rich and valuable to historians, students, scholars, journalists, and others. She is herself a commentator for national and international news sources, including CBS, CNN, Fox News, MSNBC, and she's an expert on the presidency of the Kennedys, the Kennedy family, and her work includes a couple of important books, Rose Kennedy, The Life and Times of a Political Matriarch, which we could probably do, Barbara, a week's worth of programming on that alone, and her book here, which is a wonderful book itself, Jacqueline Kennedy, First Lady of the New Frontier, among other works that she has. This is a wonderful book, and we'll be speaking about this today. So I would like to invite them up to join me. I'm going to have a brief conversation, and then we invite you to answer your questions, to ask your questions, and they'll answer them as well. So continue your meals and enjoy our conversation, and I'll invite them to come forward.
Here, I'm Barbara. Well, we have a little bit of a challenge because my questions were right here on a little card. So absent my questions, I'm just going to dive in. Well, we're here to talk about Jackie Kennedy and John Kennedy and their life and their leadership. Why has this presidency been so much of interest to Americans throughout time? Why do they continue to be so popular but so much of interest that we would gather a whole room full of people here today to talk about them?
Let's go with the president.
No, please.
Well, Camelot.
Thank you.
And when you say Camelot, as Mrs. Kennedy had hoped in that famous interview that she did with Theodore White just 1 week after the assassination at the Kennedy home at Hyannisport, the week of Thanksgiving, 1963, that she said, there'll be great presidents after my husband, but there'll never be another Camelot. And if you think of the wording of the Lerner and Lowe musical that she was talking about, it was, don't let it be forgot that once there was a spot for one brief shining moment known as Camelot. And for whatever one thinks about mythology, remember Camelot itself was the mythology of the mythological King Arthur. So Mrs. Kennedy layered a legend upon a legend, but it stuck, and we think of it to this day. It was brief, literally, 136 days of the Kennedy presidency, and that she was first lady. And they were bright and effervescent people. All you have to do is look at the photos from that era. Mm. So if it was that alone, plus the tragedy of the assassination and how it ended and how this beautiful couple with those two beguiling children were taken from the national scene, but also all that she did in her legacy in making the White House a symbol not only for our country here, but of democracy around the world in the midst of the Cold War. So if I had to sum it up in that way, that's how I would do it.
Well, first of all, what a pleasure it is to be sharing the stage with these two friends of mine, Stewart and Barbara Bard. But I want to echo what Stewart said. The best center for presidential study in the United States of America is the Miller Center, where Barbara plays such a vital role. And I want to echo what Teresa said about your leadership at the White House Historical Association, Stewart, and the phenomenal job you have done. I want to just thank you all for supporting the White House Historical Association and the phenomenal work you do. And I say that as a lover of history and a proud American. The work that you're doing is vitally important. You put it so well, Barbara, about their alluring appeal, but I'll just share a quick story with you, and that is that, you know, John F. Kennedy only won the presidency by 0.2 percentage points. 118,000 votes are the difference between John F. Kennedy being president and Richard Nixon. So it is the narrowest victory of the 20th century. Richard Nixon, who attended the inauguration, is leaving, and he runs into Ted Sorensen, who had a hand in the speech, that the iconic inauguration rhetoric that John F. Kennedy had given that day. And Nixon turns to Sorensen and says, you know, I wish I had said some of those things. And Sorensen said, you know, which part? Meaning, you know, he thinks he's going to say the ask not part. And Nixon replies, the part where he says, I do solemnly swear. But the thing is that between the time that the election occurs and that inauguration speech, the American people become swept up in the romance of the Kennedy presidency, these young, vital, attractive, elegant people taking the helm of our country and living in the White House, the president and first lady of our nation. 43-year-old John F. Kennedy, the youngest president-elect we ever had, 31-year-old Jacqueline Kennedy, the first lady. And as Barbara suggests, they just cast such an alluring image. They did then, and they did now. Cindy Seide Buck is here, and I was blessed to be a friend of her father, Hugh Sides, who covered the White House for Time magazine. And I remember Hugh telling me how proud he was as an American when the Kennedys would go abroad representing our nation. They looked like we, I think, want to look as a nation. They're young, they're vital, they're rampantly ambitious, they're elegant, they're eloquent. They're exactly the way that we want to be seen on the world stage, and they continue to be, to some degree, our royalty.
Barbara, you grew up in Kentucky, and as a young girl, your mother took you to see President Kennedy, and I believe that had an impact on you.
It did. Thank you for bringing that up, and thank you to my fellow bluegrass denizens. And I've just come from Louisville, in fact. Yes, and October 1960, my mother packed me and my two older brothers into our car in the suburbs of Louisville and drove us downtown. And until she passed, she'd say, "Remember, I got there early and I put you right in front of the podium where John F. Kennedy spoke." And I'd say, "Mother, I can't remember the speech. I was only four, but I sure remember what a four-year-old would remember, the confetti and the balloons and the excitement." And then I'd sort of tease her, but it's the truth. I'd say, "You turned me into a political scientist and a presidential historian at age four." And the reason I bring it up as part of the scholarship that I do on the Kennedys is that my mother wasn't a political scientist or a historian. She wasn't involved in politics. I mean, she was interested in history and she voted. She was a homemaker in the suburbs of Louisville raising three baby boom children. What possessed her to go see this candidate, as it turned out, 1 month before that very tight election? And I have to say, it was because he was of her generation. We're Catholic. My dad was a World War II veteran. He was a war hero. And John Kennedy was handsome. And my mother was completely taken with him and Jacqueline Kennedy. And she read everything she could get her hands on and passed that on to me, and that love of the presidency and the White House and First Ladies to me. And then we discovered that my grandparents, when the president died, my grandparents had a little shotgun house, they call it, in Louisville. They cut out a picture of President Kennedy from a magazine, and they put it in probably a dime store frame, and it was in their living room. And when my dad's mother passed away, we discovered she had kept, in effect, a clipping service of the Kennedys. And so I have inherited that, and I've used it in my research. But she would just see pictures and stories about the Kennedys in the local Louisville paper, and she would cut them out and save them. So to me, it is, I lived the impact of these people on average Americans, and it shaped my life and career, thank goodness.
Well, we're here in extraordinary New York City, and Jackie Kennedy spent much of her youth in this city and was exposed to New York as a young girl, but she returned to New York later in life, and I'm curious, Barbara, on your perspective on New York's impact on her, both as a young girl, but later in life, but also Mrs. Kennedy's impact on New York when she returned here and the lasting legacy that she has on this city as well.
Sure. Well, I can say that while I had been introduced to the future president 1 month before he was elected in 1960, as a four-year-old, I wasn't as aware of Mrs. Kennedy, and the first time I became aware of her was on that fateful day, November 22nd, 1963, a second grader in a Catholic school in Louisville. And we were taken to church to pray for the president. And I remember the assistant pastor leading the rosary, but saying the president had been shot in a motorcade in Dallas, but that Mrs. Kennedy was uninjured. And for the mind of a seven-year-old, that gave me comfort. And her impact here in New York is not only, as you say, that her roots are here, that when she could no longer really abide the memories, the painful memories of Washington after 1963, though she tried to settle with her two children in Georgetown because that's where she and the president had lived before they went to the White House, she decided that she had to escape the tourism, the people peering in her windows in Georgetown, the tour buses constantly going by with their patter on the loudspeaker. So I think she thought she could try to meld into the 8 million people here. Now we know that because of who she was, that was impossible, but at least she was close to her roots. And then the impact that most people know is her saving of Grand Central Station. I was telling Cindy last night, my two parents coming here during World War II, my dad was stationed at Aberdeen Proving Ground in Maryland. They'd get on the train and come into the nightclubs here and see the sights. And two people from little Kentucky said to a police officer, "Where is Grand Central Station?" And he said, "Right behind you." They were standing in front of it. But if it weren't for Mrs. Kennedy, we wouldn't be able to see the beautiful Grand Central Station. So her impact on the arts and culture here, much as when she was First Lady, preservation, historical preservation, she certainly had as much impact here. And when she passed away at her penthouse on Fifth Avenue, which is where she wanted to be when she passed into the great beyond, and then was at her funeral mass at St. Ignatius Loyola, a few blocks away, where she had been baptized and confirmed, that obviously was very meaningful to me.
Mark, it's rare in modern American presidencies to have young children in the White House, and that's a whole different dynamic. And this period of time in the early 60s was a dramatic, traumatic time in our country. Tell us about the family dynamic during the Cuban Missile Crisis and any special insights you have into them at that time.
Yeah, I think one of the reasons we were also beguiled by the Kennedys is because, as you suggested, they were the first family to have young kids in the White House since Theodore Roosevelt. Theodore Roosevelt was our youngest president at age 42, albeit upon the assassination of William McKinley. So not the youngest president-elect, but the youngest president. America was captured by, you know, these young kids. And we can remember that photograph of John F. Kennedy Jr. popping in out of the Resolute desk in the White House. And Kennedy knew the power of imagery. And when Jacqueline Kennedy would leave the White House, he'd bring the kids in and invite the photographers in, and they'd take these photographs of the kids, which were a gold mine to magazine publishers. You know, readers loved them. But in terms of the Cuban Missile Crisis, Jackie Kennedy finds out that there is this crisis brewing because the Soviet Union had shipped missiles, nuclear warheads, and troops to Cuba, putting us on the brink of nuclear war, probably the closest we've ever come to a nuclear exchange, and perhaps the most dangerous moment in humankind. These are 13 harrowing days of the Cuban Missile Crisis. But in advance of that, Kennedy calls his wife, who's at Glen Okra, the estate that they had in the Virginia horse country, and he lets her know that she should come back to the White House, and he tells her that evening about what is brewing, what is imminent. And he tells her that she should leave. Mm-hmm. And to her everlasting credit, she says, no, we're staying here with you. If there's a nuclear exchange, we want to be with you. Mm-hmm. We want to die with you. But she also knows the vital role she will play for her husband as his confidant in chief, as his most loyal and ardent supporter. And as she says during that time, day became night and night became day. They were indistinguishable from one another. She walked with him around South Lawn at times when he needed to get some air. She was with him day and night, and I think that made an enormous difference. Again, this is a time when we are perilously close to nuclear annihilation. Again, the most dangerous moment in humankind, and I do think she understands the importance and the gravity of that moment and the role that she can play for her husband as commander-in-chief. Mm.
That's really amazing. And yet there was another moment also compelling and profound in their personal life just a few months before the president was assassinated in the summer of 1963 when they experienced the loss of a son, Patrick, in the White House. And tell us about the impact on them as a family. And did that begin to impact John Kennedy's thinking about his own mortality?
Yes, in August of 1963, Jackie Kennedy is pregnant with what will be their third child. She had lost a child in the 1950s, so I guess her fourth child. He is born prematurely. He's in Washington at the time. He scrambles to get on Air Force One. He goes up to see her on Cape Cod. The child has since been taken from a very small military hospital on Cape Cod and flown to Boston where he can be better taken care of. And he first visits with Jackie and then takes a helicopter to Boston to visit the child. And the child dies in his arms when they know it will not survive, with his small fingers wrapped around his father's index finger. And it has this chilling effect on John F. Kennedy. He ends up going to an empty boiler room and crying before returning to Jackie Kennedy. And America sees this happening to their first family, the loss of a child. And it's painful for the American people, just as it's painful to Jack and Jackie Kennedy. But I think, you know, the Kennedys had trouble in their marriage, a lot of trouble. And I think when Jack Kennedy was going from Washington to Cape Cod to be with his wife on that day, he was probably painfully aware that he wasn't there for her at moments like this, earlier tragic moments in their marriage. He was aware of that, and so it was important that he be there. But I think that the Kennedys, because of the Cuban Missile Crisis and other crises that he faced and the weight of the job, became closer in that in their White House. She called them their happiest years, those White House years. And I think that episode, that tragedy, further bound them together, just as it further bound the American people to Jack and Jackie Kennedy. Mm.
One of the roles, which many of you may know, that we have as the White House Historical Association is we fund the presidential and first lady portraits with each presidency going back to the Kennedys. In fact, today the White House is going to announce that on September the 7th, the portraits for President and Mrs. Obama will be revealed at the White House, and those were portraits that we worked with the artist to have those painted. But I say that to segue into another important moment in the family of Jacqueline Kennedy and Caroline and John after the president has passed, and it's the next time they actually go to the White House, the first time she's back in that home since they had to leave. Share that experience with us, Barbara.
That takes place in 1971, so she has not been back to the White House since she walked out in December of 1963 to move on to Georgetown. And she had been invited back by the Johnsons, by the Nixons, and she would say the same thing every time. I'm so sorry. It would be too sad for me. I mean, imagine to go back into that setting after losing her husband in such a horrific way and knowing that his casket was brought back that night and it was in the East Room and knowing that her children had had such happy times there. She just couldn't bring herself to do it. So she didn't want to come back for any kind of official unveiling of the portrait, the official portrait of herself and her husband, because she couldn't stand that blare of the lights, the blare of the cameras, the intrusiveness. But the Nixons convinced her to come back just for a private showing, that she would bring the two children, she'd come back and have dinner with the Nixons and their two older daughters, Julie and Tricia. And the letter that Mrs. Kennedy writes to the Nixons thanking them just tears at your heart, but in a good way. She says, thank you for giving me this opportunity to bring my little children, who still are very young, back to where they knew their father. Mm-hmm. And certainly for Caroline, who did know her, she knew her father at age 6. Now John was just turned 3 the day of his dad's funeral, so it was harder for him. And he said into adulthood, I don't even know what I remember of him because people tell me stories and I see him on video, and so I can't even separate, but Caroline could. And so Jackie said, to be able to bring my children back and show them the where they were with their daddy. And then she said, when we got back to New York that night, she said, I went into their rooms to say goodnight, and I would take the pictures of them with their dad, and I'd say, remember tonight, we were here. This is where you were in the photograph with daddy. And so she couldn't thank the Nixons enough and said also, if my Caroline turns out just half as well as your beautiful daughters, I will be so happy and thrilled. So it's just a moving moment for her, and I think it's the one and only time she returns to the White House in her life after her husband's death. Mm.
Mark, you're a historian, and typically historians reflect on the past, and you're certainly an authority on what did transpire in the Kennedy presidency. But let's contemplate a bit. Suppose he had not been assassinated in Dallas, and that had been a 4-year or an 8-year presidency. What do you think the whole of the presidency of John F. Kennedy would have looked like had it extended that length of time?
You know, Barbara mentioned the power of the Camelot myth, which is spun after John F. Kennedy's assassination. And it is powerful, partly because we can imagine what would have been had this young, auspicious president continued in office. And I think there are a lot of misconceptions around that. You know, we imagine him resolving the crises that would play out in the 60s more expeditiously and more with greater alacrity than the leaders that we had, Lyndon Johnson in particular. But I think there's the biggest misconception is that he would have pulled out of Vietnam. And I hear this a lot being around the legacy of Lyndon Johnson. The fact is that that came along later, this notion that he was going to pull out after winning re-election in 1964. And there's a pretty good reason to spin that in the late 1960s. The approval around the war was ebbing, and it was gnawing at the presidency of Lyndon Johnson. But importantly, Bobby Kennedy had presidential aspirations and had spoken out against the war. So it was expedient for the American people to think that Jack Kennedy would have taken a different course in Vietnam, that he would have been prudent in a manner that Lyndon Johnson was not. But the fact is there's no real evidence of that. None of his advisors, all of whom Lyndon Johnson retained when he became president, were advising Kennedy on a different course. We can infer, Stewart, based on his prudence and his avoidance of military conflict, that he might have taken a different tact. He declines not to engage militarily in Laos, which is potentially going to fall to communism. He doesn't continue to rattle swords after the Berlin Wall goes up. The Cuban Missile Crisis is resolved peacefully, despite the fact that the Soviet Union has shot down an American pilot. So there are all these opportunities for engagement in those instances. And Kennedy, who has seen war firsthand, I think that's really important. His war experience is so important in his viewpoint about military conflict, understands that that is the not the right course. And he resists the jingoistic advice of his military. But again, it would have been very difficult for him to just fold and say, we're pulling out of Vietnam, at a time when the domino theory was the dominant theory about what would occur if you let a nation fall to communism. So it's those might have beens that we can talk about hypothetically, but don't have really concrete answers around.
Well, in terms of Mrs. Kennedy, Barbara, similar, same question. And from the association perspective, we know a first lady who, as has been said, is 31 years old when her husband is elected. She comes into office thinking that she should at least have 4 years, if not 8 years. But what she puts in place in those less than 3 years, the White House Historical Association, the selection of the first curator, the beginning of the first White House collection and setting that museum standard, the creation of the group that has eventually evolved into the Committee for the Preservation of the White House, things that still govern the conservation, preservation, acquisition at the White House today. Every First Lady has benefited since then. She did that in less than 3 years. Had she been First Lady for 4 or even 8, speculate what more she may have done.
Well, you alerted us to this, and maybe because I'm trained as a political scientist rather than a historian, I tend to think of the present and what's happening, and yes, look back, but I'm not very good at predicting, so I had never stopped to think, what if she, I'd often thought, what if the president had had 8 years, and what would have happened in Vietnam and civil rights, and but I hadn't stopped to think about that for Mrs. Kennedy, so I've actually made a little list. Here, to Stewart's point, just think if she had been there 5 more years and what she accomplished in 3 years, you could maybe double that. Would that have been possible? Just think of what she, what more she might have done with the association. I'll name one other related element, Blair House. So some of you at the table were saying that you had seen the Metropolitan Museum of Art back in the early 2000s did that wonderful exhibit of Mrs. Kennedy's wardrobe. And it went all over the country. I saw it at the Corcoran Gallery in Washington. It went to the Field Museum in Chicago. But if you saw that, you would have seen a letter that she wrote to Henry DuPont, the head of the Winterthur Museum. And she said, you know, we're on our underway with restoring the White House, but might we also think about restoring Blair House? Because in the midst of the Cold War, this is where we put up heads of state. And she said, they've probably just been to the Kremlin, and she said, eaten off Ivan the Terrible gold plate. And then we send them to the Blair House, and she said, it has a ghastly television, and it has wire coat hangers. I thought only Joan Crawford worried about wire coat hangers, but apparently Mrs. Kennedy did too. The wallpaper is peeling. So eventually, Blair House was restored, but I presume she would have had a role in that. As she and the president came down Pennsylvania Avenue after the inaugural ceremony on their way to the White House, I think they were commenting either during or after about how shabby Pennsylvania Avenue looked. So they've put together, I think began to put together a commission to think about how that should look. So I suspect she would have been involved in that as well. The Cultural Center, which we know becomes the John F. Kennedy Center for the Performing Arts, and she was already involved in fundraising for it, and then because of the tragic death of her husband, it is named for him. It's sort of an interesting, you know, what if he hadn't died so tragically, would it have been the Kennedy Center? Would it have been named the Lyndon Johnson Center or the Richard Nixon Center? Would there have been a Richard Nixon without Johnson and without Kennedy? Just think of this. They were in Texas, and I was talking to, where's Becky? I was talking to Becky at the reception about the Kennedys coming to Texas, and really that was an unofficial kickoff of the 1964 campaign, and Mrs. Kennedy hadn't been able to do a lot of campaigning in 60 because she was pregnant with John Jr. So would she have done a lot more campaigning with the president in 1964? So she would have developed that side of her. And then would she have continued her international diplomacy? She had already gone to, by herself, to Pakistan and to India in 1962, made a great diplomatic tour there to two countries that don't get along, and in the midst of the Cold War, that was important. She accompanied her husband famously to Paris and to the summit in Vienna with Khrushchev. And while her husband was having what he said was he was being pretty much devastated and by Khrushchev, but Khrushchev loved Mrs. Kennedy, and they hit it off at the Schönbrunn Palace State Dinner. So would she have done more of that? Would Camelot have been a thing? I suspect not. I don't think if they had left the White House on January the 20th of 1969 that she would have called Theodore White in the next week and talked about Camelot.
Right.
I don't think that it was the necessity for a tragedy to get us to Camelot. So that's interesting to say that might not be the way we see them. And then finally, would Grand Central Station be above ground? Because I kind of doubt they would have settled in New York City. I don't know where they would have settled. They might have. I mean, his family had come here when he was a teenager and lived just outside the city, north of the city. So maybe they would have. Maybe she would have convinced him to do that. Or maybe they would have gone back to Massachusetts or stayed in Washington. But maybe her roots wouldn't have brought them both here. Mm-hmm. The other is, she said when she left Otis Air Force Base, that little hospital that they had set up for her there in case she came to have her child, which she ultimately did, and then Patrick died, she said to them as she left, I hope to be back next summer and have a baby here. Mm-hmm. So she was already thinking about the third child that they would have, and I bet if the good Lord had willed, that they would have had a third child in the White House.
Stewart, I've had the pleasure of interviewing a number of presidents, and among them are George W. Bush and Barack Obama, both of whom told me, you know, after 8 years, the American people get kind of tired of you. Those last 2 years are really a tough slog. And it's true, if you look at how we scrutinize our presidents in those last years, we kind of can't wait for them to pack their bags. The Kennedys were slightly different in the sense that they were so captivating. So I don't know if this would have happened to them, if the bloom would have been off the rose or not, but I think we probably wouldn't, to your point, Barbara, see them in the same manner that we do today.
And I'm sure Mark knows this poll, and Stewart too. In 2010, Gallup did a poll of the American people. If you could pick your favorite president or the president you approve of the most of the last nine, at that time in 2010, and they didn't include W. Bush, which would it be? And President Kennedy came out at the top with 89% approval rating, followed closely by Ronald Reagan and, interestingly, Bill Clinton, two two-term presidents. We tend to say, don't let the door hit you on the way out after 8 years, but then we suddenly become pretty nostalgic about them and their popularities arise. But I just thought that was fascinating that President Kennedy would be at the top with 89% approval in 2000.
Well, I have one more question, and then we'll take two from our audience. But I do want to comment, on this occasion, we speak obviously about Mrs. Kennedy and her legacy. But every First Lady that we've had the privilege of working with, we have a really dynamic relationship. I think it's important to note that the sudden elevation of Mrs. Johnson to being First Lady after the assassination, I think there was some anxiety on her part of would others respond to maintain the work that Mrs. Kennedy had started. But with Mrs. Johnson, she did a terrific job, and we had our own legacy of work with her. And then Pat Nixon contributed more items through the White House Historical Association than any First Lady that we've worked with, items of Americana, a real unheralded legacy in that regard. So I think there's so much that we could talk about all these amazing, incredible women. But I want to close with an iconic image. And in the news right now, we're talking a lot about presidential transition of power. And with elections, you can anticipate. Inaugurations, you can anticipate. But assassinations, you cannot. And there's that amazing photograph of Lyndon Johnson being sworn in as President of the United States aboard the aircraft at Love Field in Dallas, and there was an important person present. Tell us who that was and why in the former First Lady.
You know, so the Johnsons and Mrs. Kennedy obviously go back to Air Force One, and they want to be airborne as quickly as possible. This is on that harrowing afternoon of November 22nd, 1963. Bear in mind that they didn't expect that the President and First Lady would be able, or anyone would be back to fly off. So the main cabin of Air Force One is stiflingly hot on this very warm November day in 1963. It's an awkward situation. You have the First Lady of the United States who's just, or former First Lady of the United States who's just lost her husband in a brutal murder, sitting in the President's cabin, still wearing the dress on which his blood appears. And Johnson doesn't know what to do. They're trying very delicately to step around her. But when he is sworn into office, as he is by Sarah Hughes, a judge that President Kennedy, a female judge that President Kennedy appointed from Dallas, Johnson feels it's the right thing to do to ask her if she wants to be president. And Jacqueline Kennedy, to her everlasting credit, says, I think I should be there for the American people. As much as she's going through personally, having lost her beloved husband, she understands for the sake of history and for the sake of continuity, to your point about the peaceful transfer of power, Stewart, she understands that her symbolism, her being there, is a symbol of the peaceful transfer of power. Mm. She gets up from in all her grief, and she goes, and she and Lady Bird Johnson flank Lyndon Johnson as he takes the oath of office. Mm.
Very powerful image, and obviously the First Ladies have had a significant role with us, but also with their husbands and for our country. Just a couple of questions, and then we'll close and try to have everybody out on time. Does anybody have a question? Yes.
Here's a microphone for you.
The question was, when he was running for office in 1960, was there any truth to some speculation that she was a political liability?
She said herself in her oral history, and that is the source of Mark's riveting conversation about the Cuban Missile Crisis, that she, a few months after the assassination, she allows Arthur Schlesinger Jr., the great Harvard historian, Pulitzer Prize winner, and in effect her husband's in-house historian, to do this amazing oral history with her. So if you haven't heard it or read it, please get it. It's amazing. And she talks about these things. She talks about the fact that she was viewed as a liability in the 1960 campaign because of her fashions. Someone remarked to her that, was it true that she spent $30,000 a year on her wardrobe? And she responded, I couldn't spend that much if I wore sable undergarments. And so she had a bit of an edge as she came back because that really upset her, and she didn't want to be a liability to her husband. Then she said, then I get into the White House and all the things that were said to be a liability, my sense of fashion, my European airs, my culture, my ability to speak French fluently. Suddenly that all becomes a benefit. But she found it quite ironic and said so herself.
Thank you. One more. Yes.
When I got out of graduate school to help my income, I worked at Bergdorf Goodman. And I worked in the evening from about 5:30 until they closed on Thursday night and on Saturday. And on that Thursday evening, Mrs. Onassis was in shopping, and as she was leaving, the alarm went off, because someone forgot to take the tag off of one of the pieces that she had purchased. And she was very gracious, thought nothing of it, and they took it off and she left. And it was kind of just an elegant lady that had, you know, so much going for her that she was incredibly gracious and just a delightful lady.
So you're saying she wasn't a kleptomaniac?
No, she wasn't. Good. But I can add one more story. As I worked my way up, I was at one of the major cosmetic companies, and our offices were in the General Motors building. And the president of the division wanted to take me out to lunch because I had been made a vice president. And I got my hair cut at Thomas Morrissey because he was a friend of mine. And Thomas Morrissey left Kenneth and opened up his own salon. And the majority of the staff followed him to his new location, as did Mrs. Onassis. So I would run into her many times when I was getting my hair cut, because Thomas was a friend, and she began to know my name, and I would say hello to her. Well, the day that the president of this billion-dollar company today was taking me to lunch, we were coming down Fifth Avenue, and he's always thought of himself as being, you know, someone who knows everyone and very prestigious. And as we're going down Fifth Avenue to go to a restaurant, Mrs. Onassis is coming up Fifth Avenue, and we just look at each other, and she goes, "Hello, Joseph." And I went, "Mrs. Onassis, how are you?" Well, the CEO of the company about fell on the floor of Fifth Avenue because she spoke to me and knew my name. But, you know, she was just an incredible lady, and I like those memories. You know, they'll go with me to the grave.
Well, I think that's a nice way to close and illustrates that these men and their wives, one day soon, will have a woman elected to be president. But at the end of the day, they're real people, and they have real lives, and they have real families and emotions and family traumas and living in the White House. And this illustrates that they are, after all, real people. And so it's our privilege to help tell their stories. They are a key part of White House history, just as actually each of you are. Each of you are enabling the stories to be told to generation to generation to generation. And I want to thank you all for being here today. I think a few references were made to Caroline Kennedy, and we're all honored that she currently represents our country to Australia, and we're deeply honored to have the ambassador of Australia and his wife Elizabeth here today. And we're equally honored to have everyone who is with us. Now, we have a really special treat. You're welcome to linger and enjoy your dessert and your coffee, but on the fourth floor is the extraordinary new exhibit that the New York Historical Society has of a replica Oval Office and an exhibit on the presidency. This actually replicates the Reagan Oval Office, and we worked with them. They came down and we went into the Oval, and you can imagine they're in there with tape measures and all of this, and looking at every little piece, and then we worked collaboratively with them in the Reagan Library, and that Oval Office is replicated on the fourth floor, and you're invited to visit before you leave today. I want to thank you all for being here. It's an inspiration to me to have your support and your friendship. We could not do what we do without you, and you make it all possible, and for that, we're very grateful. Thank you to Barbara and to Mark and to everyone watching. Thank you. And have a great day.
Thank you, Stewart.